remind us where you are.
Remind us where you are.
Let this be our prayer.
Let this be our prayer.
When shadows fill our days.
When shadows fill our days.
Lead us to a place. Stay so we'll be saved. A world where pain and sorrow will be mended, and every heart that's broken will be mended, and we'll
Tiara and Nicholas, and I went on in on that one for many reasons, and I know if my daughter is watching, she's shouting and knowing many of the reasons we are. I just leave that alone. I don't want, let me get on to the word. Y'all mess me up in here. But it's good mess up. Thank you for letting God use you, Tiara and Nicholas. We bless the Lord for you today. One verse of scripture, one verse. 1 Chronicles 12:32. 1 Chronicles 12:32. And here's what it says. Just simply says, from Issachar, men who understood the times and knew what Israel should do. That's it. Pivot for progress. Pivot for progress. In this post-pandemic, or as we find our way through this post-pandemic, it's important to pay attention to language and its intentionality. What we are discovering is major corporations, our various levels of government are adopting new catchphrases and language to help us manage in post-pandemic spaces. In many cases, that language is counter to what we are saying here in the church. If you can just turn down the monitors just a little bit, it's too hot up here. In the church, we keep saying, I want to go back, as if for the last 2.5 years, you've not been a part of the church. I may not be talking to you that are sitting here, maybe talking to somebody way out there, as the old radio broadcasters would say, out there in radio land. Uh-huh. Yeah, that was our internet phrase. That's the best we could do when we were coming along, Brother Ron. It was out there in radio land, but now on the internet, and Lord have mercy, on the cloud. And so the phrases that you hear revolve around the ability to shift paradigm quickly in this post-pandemic era. Being able to move with lightning speed to take advantages of changes and opportunities. Changes in financial markets, changes in educational systems, changes in job opportunities. For now, HR has to, along with job description, define whether this is going to be in person or virtual. And the surprising thing is the expected increase in the number of corporations that can thrive from your service but never have to see you in person. We thought it was impersonal when banks started taking tellers out of drive-thrus. I can't see you no more, can't holler at you no more. Just got to come up here and talk to the machine, Willie Pearl. And we see them closing branches and consolidating spaces because now you don't even have to go to the bank. You could, if you're not on electronic drivers, if you get a check, paper check, for whatever reason, and what is this? This is 2022. Understand that by 2030, checks will be gone. If you get a paper check, you could just deposit it with your phone. Just take a picture of it, and it goes to your bank. Make sure you don't try to cash it twice, though. Don't get in trouble like that. So they tell you to write on it, deposited. All of these changes come out of crisis. Crisis doesn't make you. It simply reveals who you are. So we found out the difference between church folks and disciples in this pandemic. Disciples say, I'm reporting for duty as best I can. What do you need? Church folks said, bye, see, you wouldn't want to be. And one of the things that I have found interesting in the new language that we hear, the new buzzwords that we hear, is this word pivot. Pivot. I went so far as to just kind of research corporations and see how they're using that word. And one of the largest corporations, they have this breakdown of job description, but then they have this bullet points, and it says ability to process change and pivot a must. Process change and then pivot. Now, for those of us who are unoriented in that regard, you do remember when you played basketball, and while we have seen kind of a lapse in this thing called traveling. We've seen a lapse in it, and what happens in college, or what happens in the women's basketball is different. What happens in the NBA, some stuff we look at and say, okay, y'all let that slide. That used to be traveling. And the whole idea is that if you have the ball in your hand and you've not yet put it to the floor to dribble it, you can pivot, leaving one foot on the ground and moving around. If you should move both at the same time, we call that traveling. And in basketball, you have to dribble while you walk. Let me say that again. In basketball, you have to be able to dribble while you walk. Somebody's going to get that in a minute. You get that in your sanctified imagination. And so in this season, we have to learn how to pivot, how to be able to move and adjust, because we don't want it to come to pass, at least in our generation, the remark that Jesus made, not that he wanted it to be that way, but he was talking to his disciples. He said one day, and he said, the challenge is that the children of darkness are wiser in this generation, hear me, than the children of light. Let me say that one more time. The children of darkness are wiser in this generation than the children of light. No, I don't think you got that. I don't think you got that. Saint of God, believer, spirit filled, born of the spirit, have the illumination of God in you. How is it that people who walk in darkness have more wisdom about how to move forward than we do? Mm-hmm. And so this word pivot. We have just come, or coming to the precipice of what we would call pandemic, and what I call pandemic part one. Did you hear that? Yeah. Pandemic part one. It's not over, and so as we're pivoting, we need to look at the word to give us solutions, some answers, some insights about how we can make a difference in this pivoting world. And so this one obscure text, if you're in the Run Your Bible, as many of us are, I haven't done a Bible check in a while, but if you're following us in the 1 year Bible, which we read, and we sent them all out to all of our guests on prayer line and gave them away so that people would have them. They're also available in a Bible app that you can hear. You can even listen to Tom Dooley read every morning all the lessons from the 1 year Bible for those of us who get challenged when we sit in the front of a book and our eyes don't want to cooperate with our desire. Here comes the men of Issachar. One verse. As the writer is going through the chronicle of who's who, they take this obscure tribe of Israel and promote it to a prominence not seen anywhere else in Scripture. Out of all the tribes that they've listed, this is the only tribe that they said they understood the times and they knew what Israel should do. Let me say that one more time. They are the only tribe that the writer concludes, looking back, who did we have on duty at that time? Only the men of Issachar understood the times they were in, present, and knew what they should do to go into a future. What is it about those men of Issachar that we could take with us? And sisters, that includes you too. What is it that we can take from these men of Issachar to help us to progress in our time? Well, I'm so glad you asked the question. I got a 5-point answer. It's called pivot. Real simple. Pivot. P-I-V-O-T. I can't remember when's the last time I did an acronym in sermon, but I did one on Friday at Bowie State University summer program. Pivot. What What is it about these men of Issachar that we can walk away with today? Well, number one, they were men of prayer. There it is. Come on, let's get it up on the screen. Prayer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're going to roll. Prayer. Communion with God. If you want to understand what's going on around you, you have to leave from around you and first be hooked up with the one who understands all things. That's called communion with God. Watch this, saint of God, because a lot of us, we found out in pandemic just how much prayer could be inside of us when we couldn't get to the church. Hello, somebody. Well, we found out when we were restricted from movement that we had to learn how to tabernacle with God right where we were. And a lot of us found out that what God is really omnipresent. He is everywhere all at the same time. Now, I know how we feel about 6810 and how we feel about 3231, how we feel about the place where we come, but a lot of us discovered that God, the same God, he manifests differently in corporate worship, but the same God will meet you in your prayer closet, in your struggle, and help you out of your situation, the same God. And prayer, very simply, is talking to God. Like one lady, I mean, this was years ago, and I love to listen to seniors. I love to listen to those who are golden age. And I was having breakfast with some brothers yesterday, and one brother kept talking about how old he is. And I looked at the other brother, and I said, now, he does know that we are all in the same age group. He does understand this. I don't know why he keeps talking about how old he is, and we all in the same boat. Hello, somebody. But I love to talk with seniors, and I remember hearing this mother say, she was talking to somebody, precious Lord. I told the Lord, precious Lord, take my hand, because if you don't take it, I don't know what I'm going to do with it. Prayer is talking to God. And in your communion with God, I don't know about you, some of you may have not yet discovered it. You do not have to use the prayer you prayed in church to get to God in your situation. Matter of fact, it's a lot better if you cry out to him. That's when you're in desperation. Because the Bible said, David said, I didn't know how to fix it up. I wasn't trained by the priest. I was just a shepherd boy. But I love the Lord. Why do you love him, David? Because he heard my cry. He heard me in prayer, talking to God. And this is not, watch this, this is not just traditional church as we know it, but it is that spiritual communion. And there is a difference between praying in secret. God says, I'll reward you openly. And there's a difference in praying in your social setting. These men, I contend, were men of prayer. When you talk up, it helps you look up. Not only were they men of prayer, I'm already at number two already. Not only were they men of prayer, they were men of investigation. They're making the pivot. There's the eye. You see it? Investigation. Watch this. Amen. Not just, I'm waiting for it to come up the screen so I can keep moving. Amen. Not just investigation, not just prayer, but men of investigation. Not just rehearsing the news, but researching the truth. Let me say that one more time. I can drop that in your spirit one more time. I really want you to get that one. Not just rehearsing the news. The news is, I heard. Mm-hmm. The truth is, I know. Can I give you a quick parallel? Let me just throw this in there so you can walk with me in this point. I heard cancer can kill you. I heard that. But I know that God is a healer. Mm-hmm. Are you hearing me? not just rehearsing the news, but researching the truth. And this takes us back to what we used to have in our community called the elders in the gates. You see it all in Scripture, and that was that place where the elders met, usually at the gate of the city, because they were gatekeepers. Hello, somebody. In other words, they wanted to ensure ain't nothing strange coming up in our hood. Hello, somebody. So they were gatekeepers. So when they sat in the gate, which is now where we get this whole thing of city councils sitting to determine what happens in a municipality, that's why our participation, let me just put that plug in right now, that's why our participation in early voting and then voting in this primary is so very critical. If you want it to come out right in November, you better walk to the poll in July. And I would say, like Forrest Gump, that's all I'm going to say about that. But that's not all I'm going to say about that. I'm gonna keep on saying it as long as God gives me breath and strength. The elders in the gate, and they determined what came in and what was left out. They were the protectors. And so these elders, these men of Issachar, they made an investigation. The backdrop of Israel's history is so filled with turmoil and situations that you could read all of that in the Chronicles, and I will not belabor that point. It's enough to understand that they were men who understood the times that they were in. They were men who understood that there was unbridled violence against black and brown. They were men who understood that we needed to ensure that the least, the lost, the last, the left out had a safety net to help them rise up to the next level, and that those who are right at the cusp of opportunity, we needed to do everything we can to push them on into success and then challenge them to reach back and get the rest of their brothers and sisters in community. These men understood that. When they investigated, they found out that lines may have been redrawn for districts, but we know how to cross lines and get people to the polls. I was privileged the other day to have a wonderful one-on-one conversation with Senator Uri Patterson, who is retiring, and he's going home and enjoying himself. I know where he lives, and I know where he's going to hang out, and I'm going to hang out there with him, too. And I said to him in the conversation, I said, someone who has been, and I don't care what you care about politics or decisions. Listen, every leader is going to have some things that people like and some be things that people didn't. That's just leadership, all right? And if you hadn't had that experience in life yet, it's because you're not doing anything and you're not leading anything. Because people that do something are going to find some resistance somewhere. So you might as well do it because you're going to get the resistance anyway. And so I said to him, I said, Senator Patterson, I said, we need men and women like you who were trailblazers to sit and talk out the journey so we could understand what you experienced. Now, I ain't trying to be no politician. That's not what I want. It's the wisdom of how to navigate in these times. And he said to me, he said, you know, we used to have those, and we don't do enough of that now. I said, now that you are retiring, coming back to the hood with us, I said, I'm going to come get you, and I'm going to set it up. So you can just talk out. You and other persons who have forged and blazed trails can talk out and help us to understand the times, and that helps us to understand our way forward. Watch this. Not only when you talk up, it helps you look up, but when you investigate out, it helps you to know what's up. Did you get that? When you investigate out around you and see what's happening, as you do your investigation, it helps you then to know what's up. If I'm talking up to God and I'm looking up to God, and then I'm also being informed on what's happening around me, which means I know what's up, I'm looking up, I'm praying up, then what's God getting ready to do? In any vessel, man or woman, if you have the boldness to pray, the boldness to investigate, then here it is, number three, he's going to give you vision. You're going to make the pivot, P-I-V-O-T, vision. Vision. Prayer and investigation help prepare the ground for the seeds of vision. Did you hear me? Seeds of vision. Let me pause there while I'm on that word seed, because it's driving something else. I said to, I was talking to a couple of actually retired preachers, and they were, we don't know where to fit in. We don't know what life is like post-active ministry. And I was sharing with them some things, and I said, you've got kingdom inside of you. Just because the law of the church said you had to retire doesn't mean that you lost the kingdom that's inside of you. And if your whole ethos ebbs and flows based on the AME church, you in trouble. Baptist church, you in trouble. Kojic, you in trouble. Your whole kingdom ethos should not ebb and flow on what's going on in the organization. Yeah, but in the kingdom. So you got kingdom locked up inside of you, and you and talking about both of y'all right. So you need to write and start sharing kingdom. And I said, you know, I never thought about it like that. I said, but now remember, old preacher told me, he's still living, 93 years old, Bishop V.T. Williams in Kingston, Jamaica. Some of you all that went with us down there met him. And Bishop V.T. Williams told me about 30 years ago, Rodney, he said, sometimes it's not that you don't have good seed, it's that you haven't sown the seed in good ground. That's why you're not seeing the harvest. Mm-mm. Vision, vision, vision. So when I pray, and these men prayed, and then they investigated the situations around them, then they were ready for vision for what God would give them to help the people move forward in the times that they were in. In the movie, the Fast and Furious series, some of you like that series as well, that and Lord of the Rings, and God knows I love Avengers. I just don't go to first night showings because I know it's going to be all crowded. I'm going to catch up with Brother Thor and Love Thunder in just a little bit. I'm going to catch up. But in the Furious 7 series, they talk about this thing called God's Eye. And in God's eye, and it is also a Native American and South American thing, because we used to make it when we were little. We'd take a cross, and then you'd take yarn, and you would just mix it around, and you'd make this square with the little eye in the middle, God's eye. And so there, this is a satellite in the movie. It's a satellite that can see all and control all. Now watch this. If you looked up, if you prayed up to God and you looked up to him for help, you investigated what's around you, then watch this. Here is where heaven interrupts what's happening in the earth. Here's where, believer, we see the realization of the prayer. Thy kingdom come. Where? On earth. How? Just like it is in heaven. So if I talk to God, if I look up to God, if I look out in humanity to see the need, God will give me a divine vision to impact the world around me. Having looked up in prayer, investigated around in harmony, then you can see beyond what presently is. Prayed up. They were investigated around, and they had vision beyond beyond what presently is. How many of you know that we need some vision beyond what presently is? We need some vision for our 10 and 11 year old males to understand you're not going to become a statistic. You are college material. You can go and have a brighter future. We need some anointed men and women who've talked to God, who've investigated around, and they see vision on how to make the world a better place. And so here's the question. When you look out, what do you see? If you see with your natural eyes, you'll see misery, pain, suffering, sickness. But if you look in your spiritual eyes, you'll see opportunity for healing, health, wholeness, transformation. There it is. Y'all pop that up right on time. Opportunity. Opportunity. Reverend, how do you look at this crazy, mixed up, evil world? Through the eyes of God. Because if you don't get his perspective, boy, this thing will wear you out. As I was sharing the other on Wednesday night in the message, don't say you can't. Don't say you can. Don't say you can. I think it's Andrew Carnegie, one of the great positive thinkers, who wrote, two men locked behind prison bars. One saw the mud. The other saw the stars. If you have the right vision, what do you see? Some people see the problem. Yeah, but I see the provider. Some people see the lack, but I see the Lord. Some people see the pain, but without pain, there can be no healing. I see the healer. Some see the thirsty. I see the living water. Some see the hungry. I see the bread of life. Some see, but what do you see with provides you with either an opportunity or an obstacle? Some say, it's raining outside. Others say, God is watering his earth. And, Reverend Lowe, he's cleaning the air. Friday, I had the privilege of speaking to the summer camp at Bowie State University, group of young men in a CPU camp. And Dr. Daryl Stone has a wonderful program there. And so I said, what do I do for this graduation? And when he gave me the list of people who had visited the class, I was like, goodness gracious. So Dr. Bro had been, she had been there, and he had a list of who's who, judges and everybody who'd come to speak to them. And then there was little old me, the pastor down from Brandywine. And so I said, Lord, what shall I say? And he said, tell these young men to live. Okay, well, they're young men. He said, yeah, but tell them to live, because young black men need to hear that more than often than they are. They watch this. They know how to die, and they sing about how they're going to die. But they need to know how to live. And so I hadn't done acronym in the whole, and I'm talking, and you know how sometimes I'm it's 3 minutes before the time, and I'm writing down the little notes, and I got the little paper, and I'm already on the Zoom call, sitting in the home studio in front of the screen and all of that. And the Lord said, live. He said, learn, invest, value, and execute. And I just walked through 10 or 12 minutes with these young men and their parents and families who were on. And as I understood what God was saying, he was also saying to us that when there are obstacles that come up, if we've been in touch with God in prayer, if we have looked up to him, if we investigated out, when God gives vision, his vision is to overcome the obstacle, which then redefines it into an opportunity. So it's how you see see it that matters. You can live if I can see that there is a tomorrow. If I can see that there is a future. If I can see it, then I can have the hope to live for it. But you know, it's hard to put new wine in old bottles. Yeah, it's hard. You can look at Eeyore in Winnie the Pooh and know it's just hard. How's it going? I don't know. Talking with one of the mothers of the church, and I've adopted her as my own. Dr. Cecilia Snowden, I shared with her the other day. I call her. She started out the pandemic as Miss Flip Phone, and now she's the Zoom and Facebook queen. And what some of you may not know is while I'm preaching up here from my tablet, oftentimes mother is talking to me in the chat on Facebook. Mother, I can't answer that. I'm standing here preaching live. Sometimes I hear where you're going, and I go ahead and say, I see you doing that. But she's a preacher's widow and held in great reverence and respect. And so I called her up to check on her. I said, you heard I was talking about you. She said, no, I hadn't, but I'll go back and look at it. that's a clue. I'm just leave that right where it is. And so we were talking about this whole season and what it provided for us. While many persons her age, 82, still counseling and advising PhD students in writing their dissertations. Hello, somebody. And still actively growing and developing at 82. I got some 32-year-olds who don't do like that. So I told her, I said, you know, I used to call you Miss Flip Phone, and now you the Meta and Zoom queen. Hello, somebody talking to me in the chat while I'm standing preaching. How's that for black call and response? She said to me, she said, Reverend, I just determined in my mind, Pastor, I determined in my mind, I may miss it the first time, but you ain't gonna catch me the second time not knowing. At 82 years old, you better believe in just these last 2 years, she has determined, I'm on now smartphone. Matter of fact, if you call her, her phone's going to ask you, who are you, that we might return the call. I said, you better go on with your high-tech self. But she said to me, we miss opportunities because we think they are obstacles. And what I used her in as example is, it's not about age. Some people are 32 with 90-year-old minds. And then there's some people who are 90 who got 32-year-old minds who say, I still want to grow. I still want to take advantage of the opportunity that God gives me each and every day. Pivot, prayer, investigation. They were men of vision, men of opportunity. And finally, they were men who had trust. You know, in this world, you have to trust somebody. I know. Darcel Wilson is—I forget all her titles. She went into retirement and then got recruited out of retirement. And I know she's gonna probably say something about me talking about her. But I love watching how God moves in His people. She was recruited by the Greater Washington Community Foundation to head its entire Prince George County arm. And you know, they give out millions. Hello. Mic check. So they recruited her. And so she invited me to her first breakfast, which was, it was quite a tease because it was up at Enterprise. Yeah, in the white the manor up there. Yeah, yeah. And the course is under construction. I said, next time y'all bring me out here, you need to bring me out here. Hello, somebody. Matter of fact, I'll bring a whole bunch of my boys. We'll come and support it. So as they begin to share their target going forward, watch this. This is people who know the times. I know the text says men who know the times, but sisters, you do understand that's talking to you too. Hello. And so their target as they're moving forward is dealing with this wealth gap that was exacerbated by the pandemic. In other words, in the pandemic, pandemic, you know the old statement of Clemens, we grew up hearing it, the rich got richer and the poor got poorer. You understand? And so as I was sitting at breakfast, as the Lord would have it, I came in, I asked what table I'm sitting at. I came in and I sat down. Of course, we had on masks, and here I get to sit next to the first black female county council member at 80 years old, Dorothy Bailey. And I sat down with her, and we had a wonderful time talking. So since I had this icon of political nuance and advantage at the table, I'm not going to let sister like that, who's got that kind of history, drop a little crumbs, some wisdom. And as I began to talk to her, and she began to tell me about those early times, and such is the case, and then I interjected to her. I said, yeah, I asked Senator Patterson, I said, would you all sit with us in community? And not to run for office, but just give us the wisdom of those who have been elders at the gate, who are still living among us. And here is what she said, and it just rang down in my spirit. She said, we don't do that like we used to, because at first there were so few of us, and we were all we had. So because there was few of us, and because we were all we had to factor in a built-in trust that says, hey, we got to do our best to pull together to make this world a better place. Because watch this, with the enemy we're going after has more resources, has a plan, has an agenda, and if we come divided, we're going to be minimalized. She said, she goes on to say, but now that there are many more of us, we are more disconnected than we have ever been. Trust. See, there's something about our common closeness that helps break down the defenses that we have to accomplish vision together. When we realize that all of us woke up black, brown, whatever color you call yourself, you woke up with certain advantages, you woke up with certain disadvantages, and if we wanted to pull back the cover and just have a real transparent conversation, all of us have dealt with some of the same demons, some of the same hell, some of the same stuff, some of the same situations, but we isolate ourselves in our little silos like we're the only ones that go through it. So watch this, when we have failures, we don't share them, and it overcomes us. When we have successes, we don't share them, and we miss the next one. We miss the next one. The old series Kung Fu, David Kane. I love this one. As a young boy, he and another Kung Fu student, the master sent them on the road to go to another Kung Fu school. Along the way, on the road, they were attacked by bandits, and whatever they had was robbed. And when they got back to their master, and Kung Fu Master was talking with them, he asked the question, now what did you learn from the experience? And David Kane, as the little boy, said, let me tell you what the other one said first. The other one says, Master, I learned never to trust anybody. And the master said, you are dismissed from this school. Leave now. And then he turns to the young David Kane. What did you learn? He said, I learned to be prepared for the unexpected. There's a difference between being prepared for the unexpected and dismissing and not trusting altogether. Yes, trust is a risk, but it's a risk that comes with progress. If we trust up to God and lock arms with one another, we can move forward even in times like these. And when I look at that locking arms motif, it takes me all the way back to the 60s, and I envision, and you remember it in the pictures, where you would see MLK and his wife Coretta next to him, and Ralph Abernathy, and Jesse Jackson, and all of those great leaders, Dr. Lowry and all of those great leaders, but along with them, you had Jewish Rabbi Robert Marx. You had other persons along of Hispanic origin and other origins. They locked arms and learned because of the times that we're in, we have to trust each other if we're going to make it and progress to a new future. Well, if you're ready to make the pivot, that means you pray, investigate, have vision, opportunity, and trust. I shared a few days ago in the series When Daddy Was Drunk. If you didn't get part two, which was Wednesday night, you can go see it. If you missed part two, you missed the pivot. Because the story of Noah is not about drinking or drunkenness. And contrary to what so many have said all of my life, Noah was not a drunk. He drank wine one time. You drink one time, all them grapes, you pass out in your tent too. What we don't see, it's not about being drunk. One event doesn't define who you are. In Noah, it's about Noah's, watch this, what I call his yield ability. And that's not a word. I've made it two words, so it'll work. Noah's yield ability to make the pivot from preacher, builder, pre-pandemic, to farmer, post-pandemic. Did you get that? It's about, can you change your goal midstream because the situation requires a pivot. Noah made the pivot for progress in the post-flood, post-pandemic season. Abraham pivoted from wanderer to settler. Joseph pivoted from prisoner to president. Rahab pivoted from harlot to heiress. Joshua pivoted from servant to leader. Ruth pivoted from outcast to royalty. David pivoted from shepherd to king. Well, he's not the only one I know who pivoted. When he pivoted, they put nails in his hand. when he pivoted, they put nails in his feet. And he went from being a babe in a manger to a rabbi teaching at a son on the shore to a savior dying on a cross. But the pivot didn't stop there. He gave it about 3 days, and then he pivoted again. He went to the cross as Savior, but he came out of the grave as Lord of Lords, King of Kings, to rule forever. He pivoted for progress. That's what God is challenging all of us to do. Make the pivot. God bless you. Our Father, we thank you now for your grace and favor. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit, and we yield to you now that you might have your way. Speak to our hearts, Holy Spirit, that this word would sink down in each of our experiences. Help us to continue to progress. Let us have some of these ingredients that the men of Issachar had. They understood the times. Why did they understand the times? They knew what Israel was supposed to do. Why did they do that? I believe it's because they knew how to pivot, to pray, investigate, to receive vision, look at opportunity, and then trust in you, and then have confidence in each other to work together, walk together toward a common goal. We pray now that your word would go forth and do in each and every one of your people that which you have ordered it to do. I pray now for healing, for deliverance, for reconciliation. I pray now that the pivoting spirit would come upon your people and help us to adjust with these times that are filled with swift transition, because we are people of the Spirit. we can move and flow with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you heard the word today and you were blessed and profoundly touched, we praise God for you. If you need to be saved or you need a church home, it's simple as ABC. Information is on the screen. You can call us, be in touch with us, or email us. And we'll help you to know the Lord in the fullness of his glory. And then if you need a church home, we'd love to have you here at the Union Bethel Church, connecting with us virtually. A couple of guys told me, one brother told me this week, you my pastor, I listen to you every Sunday. Amen. Well, praise God for the opportunity to serve anybody. And this is what we've learned in this season, that it's not just about people who can gather in one place. It's about us taking the gospel out to the world. And that is our mission and our vision for the community, to make the world a better place. Can you say amen, somebody? All right, let's pivot for progress and receive our offering, and then we'll leave from here. To those of us who are worshipers in person, you will hold in your seat, and you will provide your gift as you exit the sanctuary today. Thank you so much for helping us to protect each and every one of you. We take that very seriously. On the screen, information about how to give through Givelify or through Realm. If you're on our website, there's a donate button. You can hit that donate button, share $10, $20, whatever the Lord has blessed you to be able to share. To our members of the house, we are challenging you with summer improvement projects. Amen. And those projects have already been shared on the screen. And we're challenging every member in the course of the summer, June, July, August. Well, we're now in July, to share $100, an extra $100 per month. You can give $300 all at once, however you want to do it. $150 this month, $150 next month, however. And that's to help us with the summer improvement projects. We've already placed orders and things are already moving. As we head toward the 135th anniversary of the church, amen, it's going to be awesome. Somebody say it's going to be awesome. Amen. And in the words of Brother Beasley, as we were looking at that a few years ago, he said, Pastor, why don't we do the big one every 5 years? So I said, yeah. So it's that time. It's passed just that quick since we had the 130th, now 135 years of celebrating the Lord's grace and favor upon us. Wherever you are, we always hold up our phones as a sign of giving electronically. If you do that, that's fine. If you've already given electronically, you lift up your hand, whether you're in your home, sitting at your kitchen table with your coffee and your grits and eggs, hello somebody. Now, God, I ask that you bless the seed that is being sown and the ones who are sowing it. Bless the gift that are being given, and bless the ones who give it, that it would return to the sower and the giver 30, 60, and 100 times. And then that the gift itself would perpetuate and be in the world of ministry to minister to those in need. And we thank you for that opportunity to bless your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your gifts. As we get ready to leave from this place, we give God praise and glory for all that he has done. What did those men of Issachar knew? They knew, they understood the times, and they knew what Israel should do. They were men that knew how to pivot. And if I can just add parenthetically, probably a lot of them got their pivot from mama's nudge. I'll just leave that alone. Y'all know what that is? Yeah. So that means there's some sisters who knew how to pivot too and understand the times and know what needs to be done. And as they pivoted, God blessed them. And as we pivot with God, he will bless us. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and honor, dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen. God bless you. I love you. Until I see you again, remember, pivot for progress. You will remain in your seats till you are instructed and directed by the ushers. Let me give you my big hug. Love you much. God bless you.